These are the solutions for problem set number 5 for biochemistry free and all, and also for Kevin Ahern's biochemistry 450 at Oregon State University. This problem set relates to the protein hemoglobin and the hemoglobin lecture given in the video. Problem number 1 says a mutant hemoglobin is found in which a single amino acid is changed. The amino acid changed is the histidine attached to the iron atom of the alpha subunit. Predict the effect this would have on hemoglobin's properties. Well, in this case, the alteration of histidine to another amino acid would likely mean that the amino acid in its place would not be able to form the covalent bond with iron that histidine does. As a consequence of that, the histidine this is problem set number 5 for biochemistry free for all, and is part of the BB450 class taught by Kevin Ahern at Oregon State University. This problem set relates to hemoglobin. Problem number 1 says that a mutant hemoglobin is found in which a single amino acid is changed. The amino acid changed is the histidine attached to the iron atom of the alpha subunit. Predict the effect this would have on hemoglobin's properties. Well, if you change the amino acid that's attached to the iron in the hemoglobin, the new amino acid would not properly attach to the iron. So consequently, when oxygen comes in to the heme region of one of the subunits of hemoglobin, then what would happen is that the oxygen would pull the iron up as described in class, but the pulling up of the iron would not be able to pull up the amino acid attached to the iron because there would be no amino acid attached to the iron. Now, we could assume, for example, if you want, that remember that hemoglobin has 2 alpha subunits and 2 beta subunits. So we could say, for example, that the 2 alpha subunits have the mutation and the 2 beta subunits don't have the mutation. So 2 beta subunits would have a histidine that would get pulled up when the oxygen binds to the iron, and the 2 alpha subunits would have no effect as the iron was being pulled up on the binding of oxygen. So the question is, what would happen in this case? Well, the primary thing that you would likely see happen if this were the case would be that you would see no cooperativity. Because remember that cooperativity is a function of the moving up of the histidine being pulled as the iron is pulled up on the binding of oxygen. You could have the beta subunits have this effect, but since the beta subunits interact with the alpha subunits, the cooperativity would require that cooperation of all 4 subunits. So the prediction that you would make in the scenario that I have described is that you would see no cooperativity occurring. Question number 2 says, what mutations in hemoglobin would have to occur in order for it to not be able to carry carbon dioxide? And then it says, would these mutations have any other effects? Well, if we remember the binding of carbon dioxide by hemoglobin, that binding of carbon dioxide occurs, again, on histidines. These histidines, of course, are separate from the histidine that's involved in binding to the iron. And the binding of the histidine, the binding of the carbon dioxide by the histidine is an important part of the transport of carbon dioxide back to the lungs by histidine away from the tissues that metabolized it. Remember that the histidines are also important for carrying protons. And so that if we had mutations in affecting these histidines, then the mutant hemoglobin would be less able to carry protons. And that inability to carry protons would also mean that those hemoglobins would have a reduced Bohr effect, because the Bohr effect says that the binding of protons by the hemoglobin, in this case by the histidines in the hemoglobin, is what causes a favorable release of oxygen near the rapidly metabolizing tissues. So if we did not have the ability of hemoglobin to bind to those protons because the histidines had been mutated, we would see no Bohr effect as a consequence. We would also see reduced carrying capacity of carbon dioxide back to the lungs. Number three says a smoker is pregnant and carrying a fetus. Assuming the 2,3 BPG could cross into the fetal blood, what effect would it have on the fetus? Well, remember that a smoker has a higher concentration of 2,3 BPG than a non-smoker. It's why I said in class that the smoker will have less oxygen carrying capacity and therefore will get out of breath much easily during exercise. Fetal hemoglobin, you remember, is different from maternal hemoglobin. Instead of the alpha-2, beta-2 configuration found in adult hemoglobin, fetal hemoglobin is alpha-2, gamma-2. And that alpha-2, gamma-2 creates a hemoglobin that is much more commonly found in the R state than in the T state. And it's because of this that the fetal hemoglobin has a greater affinity for oxygen and is literally able to take oxygen away from mom's hemoglobin to give the fetus the oxygen that it needs. Now, the question says, assuming that the 2,3 BPG from the mother could cross into the fetal blood, what effect would it have on the fetus? Now, the surprising answer here is that the 2,3 BPG itself would have very little effect. And the reason it would have very little effect is because the alpha-2, gamma-2 fetal hemoglobin cannot bind 2,3 BPG. You recall that the hole of the donut for the fetal hemoglobin does not accommodate 2,3 BPG. It's one of the reasons why fetal hemoglobin is found in the R state more than the adult hemoglobin. Now, the mother's carrying capacity for oxygen would certainly be reduced. So I don't mean to imply that it's okay for mothers to smoke when they're carrying a fetus, because the mother's oxygen carrying capacity is reduced by the fact that her blood is carrying additional 2,3 BPG and the oxygen carrying capacity is low. But if we look only inside of the fetus, the 2,3 BPG would have no effect. Question number four says a mutant hemoglobin is found in an individual that results in it having a much greater affinity for oxygen than normal hemoglobin. Predict the effect this might have on the individual carrying it. Well, we could think of this a little bit like we think of the fetus. The fetus has a fetal hemoglobin that in fact has a greater affinity for oxygen than adult hemoglobin does. And the fetus has it for a very good reason, so that it can take oxygen away from mom. So what if I had that fetal hemoglobin, or I had a hemoglobin that was with a higher affinity for oxygen than adult hemoglobin, would it have any positive or negative effects on me? Well, the most likely effect that I would see in me if I had a hemoglobin with a higher affinity than the hemoglobin that I actually do have would be that I probably would have more difficulty with exercise, for example. The reason being that the higher affinity hemoglobin would not be as inclined to release oxygen at the places where it was needed. Remember that myoglobin has a much greater affinity for oxygen than hemoglobin does. And I talked in class about how myoglobin is very good at storing oxygen because of its high affinity, but not so good at delivering oxygen because it just doesn't want to let go of it until the oxygen concentration is very low. Hemoglobin is very well balanced to grab oxygen where it's abundant in the lungs and to release it where it's needed in rapidly metabolizing tissues. If I change the affinity of hemoglobin significantly, then I will not have as much oxygen released at the places where it's needed, such as in rapidly metabolizing tissues. So an athlete with a higher affinity for oxygen would likely have a reduced athletic ability and capacity simply because not enough oxygen would be released.